acclaimed TV celebrity chef and restaurateur, and who's also a great champion to this hospitality industry. How are you, Cyrus?
I'm very good, Reza. How are you?
Oh, good. Very well. How are you coping? I can see you've got scaffolding in the background. So you've moved premises.
We are closing down. So we got scaffolding, things scattered all over the place, equipment to be moved. So we've taken the lights out. That's why the scaffolding is still there.
Yeah. Oh, goodness me. Because, so tell me, how are you coping with all this COVID, you know, with all the lockdowns and everything, which has been going on the last several months?
I think the answer is you are just coping.
Yeah.
The thing is that one never actually knew what was to come.
Yeah.
So when the first announcement came, we were all okay. Yes, maybe 15 days, 1 month, 20 days, whatever. And then the thing never stopped.
Yes.
And then the full-fledged lockdown came, and then nothing has ever been the same since.
Right. Yes.
Because I think for many of us, we did not know what to do, how to start to reorganize yourself and change your complete business model.
Yes, of course.
That's where the difficulty lies, I think.
Yeah.
Because for many of us, we had to rethink the whole business structure.
Yeah.
And to see where and how we could do things to maybe bring small streams of revenue back into the business.
Yes, of course. Yes. Because you still got your overheads to pay, basically. That's the other thing, actually.
Oh, and the rent, that never stopped.
Yeah, exactly.
It is easy. I mean, the thing is that, yes, there was support, but that support didn't take into consideration the fixed costs.
Yeah.
And then gradually, when restaurateurs started making a bit of noise about there has to be some more freedom of paying rent over a period of time or whatever it was. So that came in. And gradually, the government put a few steps in that allowed restaurateurs to breathe. But because of the way it kept stretching and stretching and stretching, I think a vast majority have collapsed.
Yeah. Okay.
And now believe that we may hit, we've already surpassed 750,000 people out of jobs in the industry.
I know we
And
have.
It might, the feeling is it may go to 1.5 million out of the nearly 5 million this industry employs. So I think worst is yet to come,
I'm sure. We're just only seeing the beginnings of it, and it's still, we haven't seen the full effects of the outcome of all these lockdowns. It's quite shocking, actually.
It is shocking. I mean, we are into all sorts of communications. I am on different panels talking, thinking. Yes. Experts are giving advice. Experts are talking about what's to come. But that does not take care of the independent individual businessmen and who's likely to face. Because the full impact will only come once we see the little support that is given for the furlough and the little bits and pieces the council is giving for you, making sure that your staff are still employed. And that just basically covers some of the costs. So, I mean, our monthly cost without anything else is £15,000.
Yeah.
Just for rent and for national insurance, it's about 18,000 rent, national insurance, and paying the insurance on the property.
Yes. Yes.
And things like that. So you need about £20,000 just to cover your cost.
Yes.
Which is significant.
The basic cost. It's just the basic overheads, really.
Basic.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. With heat light power has never stopped. They don't give you any concessions. Mm. The VAT man is, yes, considered at the moment. Mm. PAYE is a little bit considered at the moment. They're allowing you to pay little by little in stages. But that's about it. There is nothing else coming your way unless you can really twist the magic and create good business out of something that you did not have before.
Yeah. Even say that you've got the green button to say, for example, that the government now says, OK, now it's time you can all open up your restaurant. The question would be, is that you're still going to implement social distancing. So your takings are going to be half. You're not going to still cover your costs. In the first year or two?
Because even if they reopen, the social distancing aspect will prevail. It will prevail.
Of course it will.
be wiped away, vaccine or no vaccine, there will be caution.
Yeah.
And there will be cautions. But so yes, definitely you're not looking at a full house.
No.
And if you can put screens, etc., I'm much against the screens because they make it look like a hospital.
Yeah.
Or you feel like you're standing in a bank talking to a teller through a little opening in the bottom, you know. But I think that again people have to get used to.
Yeah.
You have to get used to that.
But then also, if you say that, because the thing is, that's not what the hospitality industry is about anyway. It's not about that. That's the problem. We're not living in clinical environments. That's the other thing, you see.
But as it is, when there were small glimmers of opening,
yes,
we were having screens and we were having shields and we were wearing masks. And you had to sterilize the table after each diner left. The chairs were being... But the funny thing is that the hospitality industry in general was the most careful of all industries.
Absolutely.
And we were the one industry always victimized.
Yeah.
And this we cannot understand.
But then also, what's your thinking now? That how is the restaurant industry or the hospitality industry going to survive? Even say, you know, what's the future of the industry? Because it's going to be a very different norm now.
Yeah. I think we need to switch off that norm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everyone talks, oh, this is the new normal. I think we got to turn that bloody new normal off one time.
Good, good. I'm with you.
This industry, the second oldest profession in the world, it survived for millions and thousands of years.
Exactly.
It is going to recover again. We are full of dynamic, enthusiastic, creative people. There is no other industry that is as creative, as dynamic as our industry. You know that.
Yes, it's, I know. Yeah.
With fabulous people.
Yes.
The talent pool that we have got is amazing. And people are going to want to recreate those talents. And in all at the same time, in these last few months, look at the creativity that's come up.
Absolutely, yes.
Look at the creativity emerging. And people are thinking, okay, I can't do this. Can I do that? Can I do that? Can I do that? I think we'll see more of that.
Yes.
But what we will see is from all our old customers now, we have a 20,000 people database.
Yeah.
And we are in communication with a lot of them. And they say, we're just looking forward to a normal again. So I think many people will demand that normal. And the new normal might become a normal.
Yeah.
We will have to take precautions. We'll have to have gels. We'll have to add disinfectants. We'll have to have things like that. Unfortunately, given time, this industry will bounce back. And I am just hoping that people like us get an opportunity to talk to people to say, trust us.
Yes.
You know, you are my livelihood. I will do nothing to damage you.
Yeah.
Nothing. Because my entire livelihood depends on you, my customer.
And it seems to be we have been very, very much been put on the front line here.
It has been put to the test. I mean, I'm talking to my ex-colleagues in Bombay and Delhi.
Yes. Yes.
And they can see it, maybe they're all opened up now, but most of them could not survive. Just like London, Bombay has very high rents and rates. So the rental income has not come down. The landlords are still demanding high rents. Some of them are being more flexible.
Yeah.
Some of them understand what's going on and they will take a little hit themselves.
Yes.
The vast majority of landlords are sitting on their high horses and refusing to budge. I think we are in for the long haul. We are not in for a short haul. We're in for the long haul of trouble.
Yes.
And long haul of a little bit more suffering to come.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I just feel that too.
I mean, where we are, the disaster is the entire city of London is closed. So that's our client base. Our client base was completely wiped out. On top of that, we have this congestion charge 7 days a week till 10 o'clock in the night. So even if we were open, why would anybody want to come to me in the evening if he has to pay £35 just to come and park his car somewhere?
I know, it's ridiculous. It goes beyond the pale of logic, doesn't it, actually? And if the city is empty, congestion doesn't even arise, actually.
So the problem is that where you want to make money because of loss of revenue from transport, you're actually driving people away rather than attracting them back in and giving more liberties for people to come in and enjoy, dine, be in a nice convivial environment and have some fun and spend some money.
Absolutely. And the thing is, that are you doing any of the home deliveries or takeaways or anything like that?
So our takeaway was never good because of our location, and we are competing with very cheap Indian food in our vicinity. So our name would never come up. It would always be pushed down. But what we have done is our boxes we started, and the boxes have, touch wood, they are doing reasonably well, good. Which keeps the clock ticking.
Yeah.
I've put a stop now that we are moving out of the building. So we will restart somewhere in the first, second week of March.
Right, okay.
Now, because now we need to clear the building out and, you know, get re-established.
Yes.
But I think we will put a little bit more emphasis on that for the time being, because our cuisine is unique. We can afford to do that to a degree. It doesn't come cheap because every single courier in the country is under massive demand at the moment.
Yes, I'm sure. Absolutely. With produce and everything.
So they are now holding the trump card against you, and they bully you. Mm. And they bully you now. Because we are their victims. So all along, it was one packet or two packets. Now, if it's 30 packages, you're at their beck and call, and you have to follow their prescription of how they will operate, and you have to operate within that prescribed environment.
Quite a challenge. It's like an obstacle course all the time, really.
Our industry is always an obstacle course.
Yeah, it always has been. I know. Yeah, it's true.
It's never been. Industry, according to what people think, it's not the right thing, but this is worse. And the problem is that it is not, nothing is helping to make it smoother.
No, bumpy ride,
but now it's full of potholes.
Mm.
We need to bring it back to that bumpy ride, which we are so used to handling all the time.
Yes, because how is it also doing with the suppliers and everything too? Because your suppliers, how are you getting up with the Brexit and everything? How has that sort of affected you too in terms of getting your ingredients?
I'll tell you, first lockdown, and nobody knew what is going to happen because people don't understand who we support as an industry, from the fishermen, to the farmers, to the growers, to the transport companies, to the exporters, to importers, to everything depends on this industry. So we may generate 150 billion pounds of revenue, but we support another 500 billion pounds of businesses.
Yeah, yeah.
And suddenly nobody understood, because all our suppliers never supplied the domestic market, never supplied individual people. Most of my producers are now doing mail order, which they never did before.
Mm.
They are now trying to get into people's homes, but they don't know how to do that.
Mm.
The fishing industry went into a severe collapse suddenly, but there are now people who are supplying fish straight from the boat into your house.
Yes.
And while all this was going on, come January, we go into Brexit.
Mm.
Yeah. Wow, how nice.
Yeah.
So here now we have this big continent across the English Channel from us, trying to wield its power and give Britain as much trouble as it can for severing its ties with its brothers across the ocean.
Mm.
And I think that fallout has not happened yet. It has not been felt yet.
What sort of advice can you give to young chefs who are coming through, especially now in this sort of, in this weird, bizarre situation, actually? What advice can you give them?
Very, very good question, Reza. It's a very clever question. So, great part of last year, when we were trying to grapple.
Yes.
Now, we run a competition called Zest Quest Asia.
Yeah.
It's always been my passion that Asian cuisine should be considered as on par with other cuisines of the world.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And also that we need at some stage to bring that back into, bring it into the curriculum.
Yes.
We started working with lots of colleges. As a result, we have a direct relationship with 110 colleges across Britain.
Right.
What I started to get information from the heads of department and the tutors is, can you please talk to our students, because they're completely demoralized, demotivated, and most of them do not think that they have a career anymore.
Mm.
Now, this is the future of the industry. We need them. We need to look after them. We need to nurture them.
Absolutely.
We need to give them the right kind of advice and support, so that when people like us move away, there is a good stream of people coming in.
Yes, of course. Yeah.
An advantage that we never had, Reza, is they have this massive pool of resources internet, exactly. All sorts of things.
Yeah.
Show them and teach them more and more. Zoom has now become the media of education.
Absolutely, that's right, yes.
Microsoft Office and whatever else has become this media for education. And I think more and more the industry that is there now, the professionals of today, need to get involved with the education sector more and more and more.
Absolutely.
So that we can give them the right impetus, we can give them the right motivation, we can give them the support that we still need you. This industry will bounce back. It is not going to die. It may have a big dip for a while, but it's going to see a rise again. And when that rise comes, your career is established.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you've got to be a little bit patient.
Yes.
You can't expect to become an executive chef in 2 years' time. And that's what they want, some of them.
Well, it's not going to happen. We know that. Have you been able to create, during the lockdown, have you been able to create any new dishes? Or are you so busy with your move at the moment, you know?
Good question again. yes, we are busy with the move. But all throughout lockdown, yeah. I suddenly had to do a lot more for my Instagram.
Yes.
And I found that there's a lot more interest in people wanting to learn to cook.
Yeah.
And we have done a few classes live as well. I'm not good because this high-tech jargon kills me. You know, it's not my cup of tea. I have to learn.
I think it's because we're old school, that's why.
Old school.
Yeah, we are.
If I ask my son, he is going to say, Dad, you're hopeless, you know. So we have this battle all the time. But I think I have to learn how to do this.
Yes.
Because I think that we have to still keep creating and we have to make people aware that now you need to buy and use more British produce. You have to.
Yes.
You have no choice. You've got to support the local economy and keep it going. And I think a great deal has happened in the last few months. Yes. I've done more than I thought I could ever do. And now I'm being pushed into doing a lot more.
Yeah. But it's really good talking to you, Chef. Really wonderful, Cyrus. So thank you so much.
Give a call. I'll call you back.
I will do that. Okay. God bless and take care. And good luck with this the move, literally. And I just hope it becomes much easier for you, Cyrus. Seriously.
Nothing is easy, but we make it easy.
Yes.
Look
absolutely.
Easy.
I'll be in touch. Definitely. Take care. God bless. Thank you.
Bye. See you soon.
Bye.